these two Kit Kats. We'll be seeing him later on in the semifinals. But we are moments away from jumping into the final quarterfinal of the day. It is going to be Reynad versus Lifecoach. I'm joined here with Chalky, cast the last match, and of course Firebat joining us as well. How you guys doing?
Doing great. Really excited for this match. Kind of has two really big names in the scene.
Yeah.
And both with, you know, Lifecoach trying to double up on tournament winnings. Reynad trying to get his first really big win.
Yeah.
I think this is going to be the most exciting matchup so far, at least on paper. These are the two titans of the quarterfinals, and these is what people have been waiting to see, I'm imagining, all morning.
Yeah. So, fourth and final quarterfinal of the day, so it's building up to this. The winner moves on to face Kit Kats in the semifinals, so it's going to be an exciting day regardless. So talking a little bit about these guys and their run through, Reynad had a little bit of a rough day yesterday. Mm-hmm. He was the one that came out second place in his group, and he struggled a little bit to actually get there. And
yeah.
People were sort
what
of
was his quote after he got through?
He was playing as terribly as he could to show how overpowered Patron was to the Blizzard balance team.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was why.
Yeah. Let's see if he goes with maybe a similar strategy this time, or if he decides maybe Lifecoach isn't the person you want to mess around against and brings kind of his A-game Patron.
So Lifecoach was the player who came out first place in his group, and we sort of called his group the group of death. He had Phone Tap in his group.
Have
he had Silence
some
in his
deaths
group.
In that group.
Yeah, exactly. It was one of the groups that everybody was saying at the beginning of the tournament, hey, that is one of the ones to watch the most.
Yeah.
So coming out first place in that group is pretty impressive feat, and Lifecoach, of course, is a lot of people's favorite to win the entire tournament.
Yeah.
And looking at their lineups a little bit as well, Lifecoach bringing pretty much the lineup that he brings to a lot of things. Paladin, Warlock, Druid.
Well, what's really interesting about his lineup is we've talked about Patron Warrior and we've talked about Hunter a lot.
Yeah.
Neither.
Yeah, neither.
Yeah.
I think he's actually the only player with neither.
Yeah.
We talked about neither Handlock nor Warrior. Well, not having Warrior or Hunter is just, like, insane. But it's worked for Lifecoach so much.
Yeah. Well, we want to give you guys a quick update on the bracket for those of you who may just be joining us or who have joined us. Very recently. We played through three quarterfinal matchups so far today. We saw Demigod, Phone Tap, and Kit Kats advance so far. So those are the three players that we have locked in for the semifinals. The final quarterfinal, which is the one that's up next, is Reynad versus Lifecoach. And then the top four will be set.
Yeah, and you know what's really exciting about this is we're guaranteed to have an up-and-coming player in the finals. It's either going to be Demigod or it's going to be Phone Tap in the finals. So.
Yeah.
No matter how the cookie crumbles, one of those two is going to make it to the finals.
And on the other side of the bracket, we're basically guaranteed to have a pretty big name. I mean, a lot of people know of Kit Kats, Reynad, of course, and Lifecoach, of course.
Yeah. So it's really going to be a Titan versus up-and-comer in the end.
Yeah.
The storylines are all built up. Well, let us know what you guys think. Stay engaged in the conversations on Twitter. Follow us at ESL Hearthstone. Use the hashtag HLS. There's a lot of people in the crowd today. It's really busy. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are excited to see the conclusion of the Season 2 Finals. So let us know what you think. And, of course, we want to give a big shout-out to our sponsors as well, Plantronics and Gigabyte, who have allowed us to fly 16 of the best players in the world out to Burbank, California, in order to compete for $25,000 worth of prizes. And, of course, those Blizzard World Championship points as well. A big shout-out to those guys. If you want to support what we do here at the Legendary Series, support Hearthstone Esports in general, check out those links below and get some of that sweet sponsor swag. I have some win rates here for you guys, during the break I worked with one of the online admins and we came up with the win rates for the classes over the course of the whole tournament.
Paladin
is the highest win rate with 87.5% win rate. They're 8-1 total.
Wow.
Only one loss for Paladin this tournament.
That's crazy.
The next highest is Warlock at 58%, so it's a big difference.
Well, I think what's more impressive about Warlock is that so many people have it, and still it has an amazing win rate.
Yeah,
that's
58% is still insane. 88% is basically just, you know, 9 games. Yeah. Anything can really happen. It was a good meta call, but
not
Warlock just showing its dominance.
Warlock is the third most popular class with 34 total games. Warrior is in first with 40 total games, then Hunter with 38 total games, and Druid with 32 total games. So the worst win rates across the tournament are Rogue and Priest. Which is to be expected. They have very low sample sizes. There was only a few players to bring Rogue and one player to bring Priest, which is Kalento.
Neither of them advanced.
The surprising one is Druid's win rate, which is a pretty abysmal 40%. 12 wins and 20 losses for Druid. So Lifecoach has the two decks with the highest win rate and then one of the decks with the lowest win rates.
Yeah, but it's still Druid, so anything can happen with the Druid. It can get those explosive starts.
But at the same time, it's easy to get kind of blinded by those explosive starts and think, well, that's a good deck, when in reality, turns out it's only winning 40% of the time, and that's just this event's win rate. But I think Druid, it's consistently been, you know,
not
that great.
Yeah.
It's been hovering around 50%, and sometimes it dips below. Is that really something you want to bring to a tournament?
Yeah.
And for Lifecoach, it is.
Another interesting statistic that I've been keeping track of, and I was trying to give you hand signals last time to show
all the Mishas.
All the Mishas. 17 Mishas over the last 2 days.
Okay.
Only 5 Leoks and only 4 Huffers.
Wow. The piggies are scarce.
Yeah. They are. All right.
For this game, we're not going to see any Mishas at all.
No Mishas.
No, okay.
Unless,
I was thinking
someone Nefarian's a hunter from the crowd. They're just like, I'll take his cards.
Yeah. Definitely going to be pitching back Savage Roar. Probably going to be pitching back everything except the Shade. You really want to have, maybe even the Shade. Just because you want Innervate and Wildgrowth that badly.
Yeah.
But personally, I favor having the Shade in this matchup just as something to do in case you whiff on the other things. And also, getting the Shade out early against Patron Warrior makes it immune to some sort of double Whirlwind turn, which can be really devastating.
You can really see Lifecoach talking himself through these mulligans, too. And one thing that I kind of thought was humorous and a little interesting was he considers everything, like even the worst plays.
He kept Emperor. It's going to be interesting.
And
to see
it leads
how that
to stuff like this. Like, maybe this is correct.
I mean, if you get an Innervate out at early Emperor, it's a big risk.
If there's someone I would trust, it's Lifecoach.
Yeah, sure.
Right,
but
like,
that is such a huge risk. That lowers your chance of having the explosive early game that you usually need to win this matchup.
Oh, he even popped the melons. Mm-hmm. Are those? Like squashes, maybe?
The most efficient play. Yeah, we actually asked him the
gets
question
those out of, his way.
Of mulligans yesterday and saying, hey, why do you keep Shade a lot? He actually was saying that he prefers to not keep Shade.
Yeah, he threw it.
Yeah, he threw it this time. But imagine if he had kept it instead of the Emperor, and now he has coin Shade into Shade. That's not even a bad curve. Maybe
but
get some early game pressure on.
If from Lifecoach's point of view, he'll tell you, like, well, the odds of you drawing the second Shade aren't high at all.
Sure.
So that opening's good. But should you really play around that, or should you play around overall what's best? And coming from like a poker background, he's always playing to the highest percentage in his mind.
But I don't know.
And on the other side of things, of course, Reynad playing Patron Warrior with so far not a very exciting start. But with that Patron, I know a lot of players are saying, one of the few ways you do lose to Druid is you just don't draw Patron in your top. Like 15 to 20 cards.
Yeah. Patron's really, really important. Druid can't efficiently remove the patrons, so just having that there, it's going to eventually hit play. Your entire deck basically combos with Patron.
Yeah.
So from Lifecoach here, do you coin out the Shade, or do you hold that coin for that Emperor, potentially?
I think you got to hold the coin.
You have to hold the coin now, I think. Yeah. Lifecoach is a big fan of doing that. Like, he will always be looking to curve out as efficiently as possible.
Yeah, and if you coin the Shade now, which is great, you get the Shade in play, it starts growing early, but unfortunately,
what do you do next?
Yeah, next turn you have nothing.
Literally nothing.
Yeah. You're hoping to try and top deck your only other 3-drop, which is the
other
Shade.
Or a Wild Growth would be okay next turn.
Sure.
But
so you got 3 draws that you could possibly get out of, what, like 25?
And he decides not to attack. I think this is correct. He won't be attacking with Hero Power at all for a while.
Yeah. Sure.
So
what about maybe hero powering the Armorsmith so it would die to a potential Wrath or the Shade when it's a 3-3 or something like that?
I think he thought about that for probably about 40 seconds in that last turn.
He definitely thought about it. So
he was thinking
this
about
must be
everything.
Right.
Yeah.
This must be right. Well, I mean, he still does make mistakes, but most of the time the mistakes he makes are due to time constraints.
Yeah.
Like, given enough time, he will probably make the correct play. I know he's taken screenshots of Patron Warrior board states and analyzed them for maybe 15 minutes.
Wow.
But you don't have that.
Yeah,
and you don't have, you know, the relaxed atmosphere that you do at home. You're basically, you're under pressure here. You only have 90 seconds a turn. You're going to have to make the best play in your mind at the time.
Yeah. And I think for this turn, it is Shade. Nothing else seems too appealing.
Yeah. No rope there.
Yeah.
He hasn't ramped up at all. I mean, no Wild Growth, no Innervates. It's keeping the Emperor Thorsand starting to look like a less and less appealing option as the game goes on, or a worse and worse keep.
Yeah, it's one of those risks that you take in bad matchups. So this isn't a good Druid matchup, so he decided in the beginning, I'm going to take a risk. Maybe I hit the Innervate, maybe I hit the Wild Growth, the risk pays off, and I can get a win out of an unfavorable matchup. But it's going to come back to bite him and make the unfavorable matchup maybe even a little bit more unfavorable.
Yeah. He could draw Innervate next turn, and it would still be not the worst thing ever.
Yeah, then it would be pretty good.
He's still quite behind. I mean, the Warrior is actually just aggressing onto him really hard.
Yeah, I like that play by Reynad, too, just putting minions on the board. That's how you beat
Especially with Grom in hand, I think he realizes, like, the way I'm going to win this game is just beating him up.
Yeah, exactly. Druid has a really hard time dealing with tons of little creatures. That's why they struggle against decks like Midrange Hunter, Zoo, and all the other sort of aggro-y tempo decks. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think you might want to Wrath Wild Growth this turn.
What?
Set up some better turns in the future. Remove a bit of damage from this board.
Yeah, I can see that.
Allows you to Emperor next turn and still keep the coin, which could be used as a flexible option later on in the game.
Mm-hmm. Now, the real question is, do you Wrath the Armorsmith to stop the armor gain, or do you Wrath the Taunt to allow your Shade to maybe efficiently trade with other minions afterwards?
What's actually pretty interesting is, and I think you do Wrath the Armorsmith, also kind of plays around Battle Rage a bit, but...
Yeah, Battle Rage is something to consider.
What's interesting is if he does get this Emperor off and saves the coin, he'll have a 4-mana Drake and a 3-mana Swipe. And Spell Power Swipe is something that can really catch you off guard as the Patron Warrior when you make a bunch of patrons, and you might have like a 3-3 and a bunch of, you know, 5-2s or 3-2s.
Yeah, that's often how the patron turns end up, too.
Yeah, and, you know, 7-mana Spell Power Swipe, that would do it.
Like, Lifecoach takes the most defensive line of trades possible here.
Interesting.
Well, not most... He takes one value trade at the end.
He's basically thinking, okay, the odds of him after Cruel Taskmastering having an efficient way of dealing one damage, not high.
Yeah.
So he's probably going to have to axe this, which he would have to do anyway next turn, if I let it grow and then kill a 3-3.
Yeah, so he's hoping to remove the weapon to maybe make Thorsen stick a little better.
Yeah, he's getting really low, but, I mean, it might work out.
Wow.
And as far as the other play, I think throwing down that Frothing Berserker is actually... the right play, because there's a big decision between whether or not to save the Frothing Berserker for combos or throw it out when you have the mana just to keep up the pressure. And against Druid, I think keeping up the pressure is the right thing.
Yeah, definitely.
You can win with Grim Patrons as opposed to some other matchups where you need the Frothing Berserkers to win.
Yeah, he already committed earlier when he threw out the Taskmaster, did all that other stuff, that he's committed to zooming down his opponent. So it stays consistent with his line of play to play the Frothing Berserker there.
Yeah, now you have the option. Do you Emperor and set up for huge swing turns coming up? Or do you go with a really defensive line? I don't think you can really afford to boom here. You could literally just die.
From, like, the Frothing getting out of control?
That happened. Yeah. That actually kind of happened last ESL Legendary Series.
If you boom here, then next turn you're going to have 7 mana, so you can do the Innervate Azurdrake Swipe to clean up the patrons, and boom usually heavily incentivizes patron turns, because they want to generate patrons off those boom bots, so I would not feel bad at all.
I think this is going to be the Innervate Swipe. This was the other play I was thinking, is you can go extremely defensive, really just take your time, make your opponent have more stuff, which it looks like they didn't. Mm-hmm. The issue here is Reynad can draw into more stuff. I think Lifecoach is really putting him on having maybe like dead cards, like Battle Rage in his hand.
Yeah. He's trying to just like stop out the aggression as soon as possible, take as little damage as possible, and let the Patron Warrior sort of fizzle out because he's wasting all those combo pieces putting on pressure.
Yeah, and we've seen this in a lot of Patron Warrior matches, and especially in Reynad's, where he goes somewhat too aggressive. I agree with it this game, but when you go aggressive with that deck, you have to realize weapons... Both Warsongs and the Grommets are your only burst.
Yeah, that's your only source of damage
at all.
And
when your opponent's at 18 and you're low on cards, you don't have really a way to kill them.
Yeah, exactly. And your minions are functioning as card draw in that deck.
Yeah.
With minions plus Whirlwind Effect plus Battle Rage, that's your card engine for the
and
entire
Life Coach
deck.
Is committed to just denying that.
Yeah, so the more minions Life Coach denies, it's going to be harder for Reynad to refill his hand.
Yeah, it's you have to make the choice as to use the pieces for draw or to use the pieces for combo. And if right. you use the pieces early on, then that means you either only combo or only draw before the game ends.
Yeah. And he's at that decision point right now to either draw off the Accolade of Bane or make a bunch of 3-3s.
He's going for 3-3s.
Yeah. He has a potential for more with these
bomb hits.
He
could get a lot here.
Yeah. This could be really good. Doesn't look like it's going to be.
That's fine for Reynad, though.
I wouldn't say that's pretty bad.
It's not bad. It's not good, though.
Yeah. Right. I think Ragnaros here is what's going to be pretty bad for him because it's very likely. It's 50-50 to hit Patron, I guess, because then you can't really hero power down the Belcher. He could hero power an Emperor.
Yeah.
Take things slow. It's not really a great way for your opponent to multiply the Patrons.
Yeah. Hero power in Emperor allows him to clear off the Sludge Belcher in its entirety.
Yeah, I know Lifecoach has been in favor of cutting Aedroid of the Claw or both in the past.
Really?
Which cuts down on your taunts. He does really like Sludge Belcher in the deck. Hmm. I'm not sure exactly what his read on this current meta is, but with the Azure Drake in the deck, you can kind of tell he had to have cut something.
One of the five jobs has to be missing, sure.
And so it's actually... I know he is not a fan of Lotheb, but I think in Druid he recognizes it's good.
It's pretty good, yeah.
Yeah.
I bet you seem surprised about the cutting the second Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, Druid of the Claw is just such... It's a great utility card. It has so many different purposes and allows you to switch in between different lines of the play, like going face and being the defensive type.
Yeah.
So like for this game, for example, he's being extremely defensive, so you'd be able to like taunt it up, and then in other games you can race with it.
Yeah, back to what I was saying was just like the only thing he really needs to seal this game up is a taunt.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, with the Whirlwind off the top, that's really important.
Yeah, that's huge.
Especially if you can draw into like an execute or even just another tool to either combo Patrons or get another draw from the Acolyte.
Wow. That is one of the best possible draws right there.
I think it is the best possible draw.
Yeah, now it's going to get him into execute.
And the second battle rage.
He's got such a huge health pool too that he can just go face, and now he has cards to refill the board. He's got the combo activator for
goodness.
That was huge. This chain of draws there.
Now it's like, how do you lose if you're in?
It went from a very, very scary game to just, wow, it looks like I win.
An empty hand with two pages on the board to a full board and a full hand.
Looks like he's going to play around combo.
Well,
was that around combo?
No,
I don't
combo
even think so.
Will kill your board anyway, so I think you're going to lose to that regardless.
Well, I mean, he played around combo killing him.
Right.
Yeah, which is more important, I think.
12, 14. No, it would have only been 30.
Yeah, that's interesting then.
But he played 30, around, 31.
He played around combo coin
something.
Anything, yeah. So this again.
This is a tough turn because...
Drake into swipe.
Yeah. If you Drake, you don't play Rag. And if you Drake into a dud, then you're just throwing...
I think
in.
Rag might be it. Oh, no, he's going to go for the swipe.
He's probably thinking the probability that he draws a dud is really low. Well,
that's
kind of a dud.
I think that does it. There doesn't seem to be any way for Lifecoach to survive through Grommish in a rage.
Yeah.
He's going to try and just play.
Yeah, he's just going
to
play everything.
Just to try and give himself the best opportunity to deal with the board.
He has that one mana wild growth.
Turn.
So he could potentially draw a combo.
Yeah.
Like, well, zero mana now.
Yeah.
But draw the full combo.
It doesn't matter because Reynad does have the
Grom do it.
Plus the Inner Rage.
It's the back of some insane draws.
Yeah. All right. Well, Reynad is going to take game number one of our final quarterfinal of the day.
Yeah. That battle rage was really key. But even if he didn't really get the battle rage, he was still in a good spot to take it. Like,
yeah, I just wonder, going back to the turn where he could have Emperored rather than the swipe keeper, very defensive play, if he went for the aggressive Emperor, then he'd have the spell power swipe to deal with that first wave of patrons. And
yeah.
Turns out that would have been correct, but...
Yeah,
Lifecoach has played very well, could have worked had those draws not gone so perfectly for Reynad.
Yeah. He tried to go with the stall out plan instead of going for the aggressive plan, which he sort of committed to early and then just followed through with it, when maybe there was a point there where he should have switched to be more aggressive.
Yeah.
But that's really, really impossible to tell when you can't see your opponent's hand, right?
Yep. I think he put Reynad on the correct cards thinking, okay, he has no draw, I can stall him out. That was correct. He didn't have any draw. He drew Acolyte, Whirlwind, into Battle Rage. Like,
and one of the key things, too, is the Belcher there that Reynad got in the mid-game. Like, usually Patron Warrior
just
only
gave
runs
him something
one
to
Belcher.
Do.
Yeah, just having a value minion instead of combo pieces is really huge when they try and stall you out like that.
Battle Rage would have been terrible there. Yeah. Would have done nothing.
Any combo card would have done nothing. Yeah. Inner Rage, Whirlwind, Battle Rage, Execute.
Yep.
All useless. So. But the value minion there is really key when they try and stall you out like that.
Yeah. All right. Well, this is actually the first time Lifecoach has been down in a series. He came out first in his group. So in the first matchup against the Rat, he won 3-0.
Wow.
And then in his second matchup against PhoneTap to move forward, he went up 2-0 and had three opportunities to win in order to close it out. So this is the first time he's actually been behind in a series.
Well, as far as lifetime, he's been behind a lot.
Yeah, well, this
he's
tournament.
He's very experienced.
He knows what he's doing.
No, the first time in existence that Lifecoach has lost the first game.
Can Reynad do it?
Yeah.
Well, getting that patron out of the way immediately for Reynad has to feel pretty good, right? Like, that was the one thing you kind of screwed up yesterday.
Yeah, and his play got better as the day went on. And so it's just going to keep getting better as he sort of gets into his groove and gets comfortable. He's actually a big threat to the rest of the tournament because, his accomplishments, he's such a good card game player.
Mm-hmm. Right. Like,
people say his preparation is
He talks himself
back.
Down a lot by saying, like, oh, you know, I don't practice. I don't, you know,
I
make
aim
good
to
decks.
Disappoint.
Yeah.
Is his,
he goes to the interview and he's like, I played as terribly as possible. But, I mean, he's just pretty naturally good.
Yeah.
Yeah, he played against Druid very well. Like, he chose the correct way to play those cards.
And he was rewarded.
Yeah, and he was rewarded just tempoing out the Druid there.
This hand is pretty sick.
Yeah.
And I think, going back to, like, this tempo mage deck Reynad has, I think if there is going to be deck he's practiced, I've seen him stream this a lot. I actually played against him on ladder, and he was playing it the last day of the season. So he obviously thinks it's pretty good, and he's played a lot of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that's a four keep from Reynad.
That's a four keep,
That's a good hand.
When you're a handlock and you see a four keep from a deck that can just burst you out.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're not, like, completely destroyed just because you are handlocked.
Oh, man.
But... Wow. There was a card that would make the hand a little better. That's one of them.
He's going to need Hellfire this game, I think.
Yeah, he's going to need it fast.
Yeah.
And by fast, you mean on turn four.
Yeah.
Right. He gets quite a few draws to get it because he is handlock.
Yeah.
He might end up Tark Bombing this, though.
Yeah, then that's just one less draw to try and find that Hellfire.
Right. He's really thinking about how much damage he can afford to take with, you know, he knows he's going to have Molten and Sun Fury.
Yeah.
But, of course, Mage has spells to get past that.
Firebag, give us the quick rundown of the Tempo Mage versus Handlock matchup. Who do you think's favored?
Tempo Mage is usually favored. They can usually get a bunch of minions down and try and zoo out the Handlock before the Handlock can really do much, and they lock up their turns with things like Dark Bomb and Coil early so they have less time to tap. And then come around board clear time, they're already low enough that the Mage can then just burst them down with Fireballs and Frostbolts and stuff. So usually the Mage has a bit of an edge, but if the Handlock is able to stabilize with maybe some Molten Giant taunts and then into heal, they're usually pretty good. But it's usually pretty hard to be able to get this situation where you can Molten Giant heal and taunt because the Tempo Mage is just so fast.
Yeah,
right. So many possibilities. So you can tell this is a tough decision for Lifecoach.
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, it's not black and white is the problem. Yeah. It's not... I can do this or this.
Yeah.
It's I can do this or draw a random card from my deck. And then you have to consider every single card in your deck, how it's going to interact with your hand going into the late game.
And how much damage that Mana Worm is going to do, when that's going to cause your Molten Giant timing to be, how much mana you're going to have on your Molten Giant timing turn to see what else you can do during that turn. If you're going to be able to like Hellfire with that or Taunt with that or heal with that.
You can look at it on the surface and say, oh, it's Lifecoach. It's a turn two rope.
Roping.
Oh, my goodness.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a crazy turn, too.
Lifecoach, I have to say it, it's one of the few times that I've seen him look stressed this weekend.
Yeah, well, when your opponent four keeps, I think you really want to Dark Bomb that, because you're just afraid of what that Mana Worm's potential is against
You're really thinking a lot into it, yeah.
Yeah, like that Mana Worm, it's a one drop, but it can take away half your life pretty quick.
Yeah.
Reynad has said it's like the best card in the deck.
Yeah.
Which I would tend to agree with. The deck, the, playing the deck with a turn one mana worm and playing the deck without a turn one mana worm, night and day.
Yeah, very different. So now the options here, we have like Owl or Sun Fury or just Tap.
Yeah. I think he'll end up going with Tap.
Yeah, you don't want to Owl that, especially going into your opponent's Flame Waker turn while they have the coin.
Yeah.
While they have the Apprentice
flame
up.
Flame Cannon for one. Like,
yeah.
One of the main ways you do get tempoed out by this Tempo Mage is trying to fight for board.
Yeah.
Against a deck that is literally built to deny you board.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, this is has the potential to be a pretty big turn, but how much does Reynad want to play around Hellfire? Flamewaker survives it, so the biggest turn he could possibly do would be something like Mana Worm or Flamewaker.
Yeah,
Flamewaker, Coin, Mana Worm, Mirror Image would be the most efficient way to do that.
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah, you get more damage from the Flamewaker, but less attack on the Mana Worm.
Yeah.
So it probably works out better.
Yeah, I think the Flamewaker is the more important.
I think
one
the main question here is, do you want to save the coin knowing you're going to have that Emperor and knowing that, okay, you can do something on turn 3. You can do something on turn 4. Turn 5 rolls around, you've gotten two more draws.
Yeah.
It's no guarantee that they're playable. You know, there's a lot of reactive cards. There's burn spells, flame cannons. So I think you want to save coin for either to proc your effects or to queen out Emperor.
So either just Mad Scientist or just Flame Waker in this situation.
Wow, that is a really like cautious play.
Yeah, we've seen a lot of pretty defensive play from Reynad with this deck.
Yeah. Like, even if a Life Coach had Hellfire, there's no way that he would even want a Hellfire there. Unfortunately for him, he doesn't have one of the 4-drops, which is really key into fighting back for board.
Yeah, he would have loved to have just played Twilight Drake last turn, but
yeah.
Owling's not too bad. And now, I think you definitely save coin for that Emperor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's kind of what that last play just sort of told
right.
us.
He's going to use this just to, you know, kind of proc stuff. He feels like he's tested for AoE enough.
Yeah. That
you probably have to trade here.
Yeah. Just, well,
I mean, Shadow Flame's not awful.
Hellfire clears the Owl anyway.
Right, so it's mostly Shadow Flame that you're thinking about.
Yeah.
It also protects one of your taunts, which helps you against Twilight Drake, against Mountain Giant.
Sure.
But
you don't have any mana to ping it on the upcoming turns, too. So getting rid of it now is pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think he was just thinking he's probably going to have to trade into it eventually. So might as well do that now. Get it out of the way. It's not like you're in a rush to lower the Handlock's life.
This hand from Life Coach is not that great. I mean, he doesn't really have many ways to deal with a big board.
He's staring down at least 7 with 2 things that scale with spells.
Yeah.
And spells deal more damage. So, like, assume your opponent has, you know, he has Coin, which is a spell.
If he has Fireball, Frostbolt.
Even his Fireball ping is so much.
Yeah.
He gains 2 more on the Mana Worm. He gains 4 shots from the Flame Waker. So that's what, like, 15, 16 from the ping, and you get 4 shots.
Yeah.
If 2 of those go face, you're dead to a Fireball.
Yeah.
But regardless, like, what option do you have? You can't just Healbot or Big Game Hunter and then your only Taunt Giver. Like, your only option in your hand right now is Mountain Giant.
Yeah, Life Coach is a little over 50-50 dead to a Fireball.
Yeah.
Which is pretty ridiculous to think about.
Yeah.
Yeah, there'll be a Fireball coming soon, but not this turn.
Yeah.
Is it esports time?
It's Coin Emperor. No,
it's Coin Emperor time.
Or is it the other esports time?
Yeah.
That's pretty esports too, yeah.
Yeah, Coin Emperor into Antonitis and then Unstable Portal.
Yeah.
That's pretty disgusting.
Yeah. Yep. The Unstable Portal will cost 1 after the Emperor. So if the Sorcerer's Apprentice dies, he can't do Antonitis and Unstable Portal on the same turn.
How much damage do you think Reynad should do here?
Wow, he's actually
going with the portal.
Flying Machine!
A Flying Machine's not going to do anything.
He's
going to play it, of course.
Yeah.
You have to.
They can get in for 2 every turn.
Yeah.
Guess he's just saving the coin for Antonitis now.
Maybe he was afraid of Shadow
and
Flame
again,
on the giant.
Just ridiculously defensive play from Reynad with this deck.
I don't know how this is
going to
work.
He does have Antonitis and Emperor.
And Coin.
Right. if he did go offensive, he would be getting punished by double mulligans.
With no burn in hand, too, so that would be horrible for him.
I feel like he is... The more mana you give the Handlock, the more sort of time and space you're giving them to stabilize.
You're getting them to that point where they can then Molten Giant and heal and taunt all in the same turn soon.
Yeah, I'm really curious what his plan was with this.
Yeah, it felt like just a really,
Coining Emperor felt super good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess he was afraid of Shadow Flame, but can you really just play around everything as the aggressive deck here? Yeah, like, Handlock has so many different tools that they can... Yeah. Implement that I feel like you have to
choose something to not play around.
You have to choose a line of play, you have to stick to it, and trading with giants does not seem to be the greatest.
Well, we have to look at it from sort of the unbiased perspective of if you're in Reynad shoes, you don't see the opponent's hand at all. But
he must be reading that there's a Shadow Flame somehow. Something gave him the tell that there's a Shadow Flame.
Yeah.
Right.
And
he's definitely playing around that, and
he maybe wasn't expecting him to have such a good hand, and or such a bad hand, and playing just Mountain Giant, he's saying that's a little fishy.
Yeah, that's a Shadow Flame, probably. Yeah.
When you do play Mountain Giant, it does seem like you not only have Shadow Flame, but you probably have Moltens because it looks like you're okay with taking damage. Yeah, you're like, sure, damage me.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't really blame him for trying to play passive.
He will get a lot of fireballs.
Yeah,
that's a good top deck.
Oh yeah,
perfect.
He needed a spell off the top, preferably a cheap one. That one will do just fine.
Yeah.
Next turn he would have 7 mana with the coin, so he could play Archmage Antoniades for 6, Frostbolt for 1, still hold on to the coin, or just throw it out there to turn it into a fireball.
Turn it into a fireball.
Which seems reasonable enough to me.
Yeah, that's 15 total damage. And right now...
Yeah, but he is going in with damage.
All right, Flying Machine, do your worst.
Imagine if he got a Clockwork Gnome, pinged it off, reversing switch.
Whoa! And Whirling Blades?
At the same time? Yeah. Sick.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Lifecoach shouldn't be afraid of getting bursted out through taunts too much, because it's pretty unrealistic to get Fireball double frostbolted.
Heal botting seems worse than taunting here.
Yeah, exactly. I feel like you need to get both the Moltens down and just throw out the Sun Fury this turn.
Yep, he's still not in amazing shape, especially that Emperor is going to activate again, and it's going to activate on fireballs.
Now, do you throw out the BGH as well to just fill up your mana and not tap?
Yeah, you definitely don't want to tap. I feel fine getting the BGH out there.
Yeah, you need just the power.
You make sure you do that first, too, so you don't kill your giant while developing it.
I think Lifecoach will
probably come up with that. Technically correct player.
Yeah, he takes a lot of time.
Until the rope hits.
Yeah. His mechanics, super on point.
Rope's halfway done.
There it is.
I've got the beast
in my sight. Comes to the same decision. Get out everything you can. Okay.
It's the same amount of attack blocking, but keeping the Molten Giant healthier could be
basically
good because you can trade it in.
Well, it's because he has the coil in hand to trade with the Emperor if the Emperor tries to value trade off.
He also doesn't want to get one Molten killed off and the other one frostbolted, which not only denies the 8 power, but also starts getting through that taunt.
Well, the Sorcerer's Apprentice allows him to use the Frostbolt for free and utilize the full effect of the coin as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's going to have... Reynad's going to have 15 damage total that can go through taunts, while Lifecoach is going to have 19 effective health thanks to the Yulebot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the Sorcerer's Apprentice actually gives you a discount next turn, though. Because it'll go down to 1 mana, and it reduces your 2 fireballs by 2.
Yeah,
so
or
that
you
would give
you
minus 1.
This turn, since you didn't see any AoE earlier, and you've
you
had
could
this
do that
massive
as well.
Board with Emperor.
And you're just going to go face, and I like that.
Yeah.
Going to see where these go. Face really good.
Yeah.
Now,
he did kind of want 1 to hit the Drake, probably.
Yeah.
So, flip side of things. Lifecoach has 24 on board.
It's a lot.
Assuming the 2/2 goes into the 0/2. You need to clear an 8/8 here. And then if your opponent has Healbot or Lotheb, you can just lose.
Yeah, you'd be a huge
because
switch
you spent too much value. So I like this. This is kind of the happy medium. You get to reduce those fireballs. which is really what you wanted. But Healbot's going to keep him in the game.
Mm-hmm. He can Mortal Coil
He's
as
gonna
well. He's
going to Coil first. Mm-hmm. Probably going to remove that Archmage. The main thing here for Lifecoach is set up Lethal next turn.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure this sets up Lethal next turn.
Yeah.
And a Frostbolt off the top looks to be Reynad's only out.
It's crazy that it came to that.
These games just keep switching, like who's going to win.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is crazy.
Well, that's sort of how it is. It's like a window.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, especially with Handlock, which lots of that in this tournament.
Yeah.
Reynad did this similar sort of line of play against a Handlock earlier in this tournament with this deck where he played around Shadowflame by fireballing an Ancient Watcher.
He also later clarified he was playing around Jiraxxus by not going face with fireballs. And I'm not sure Azkaka played Jiraxxus in his list, but of course he didn't know that. He said he was playing on one card rather than three. So defended how he played, but still, as an aggressive deck player, I really like going for lines where
they have to have it.
They will have this, or they lose.
Exactly, because they only run one, maybe two copies of that card, and you're an aggressive deck. It's very early in the game. They don't have a very high percent chance of having it, and you really have to put them on that, and that's the odds of the matchup right there.
Arcane Intellect is not the second Frostbolt, so he will have to put a Fireball into a Molten Giant to stay alive.
Well, he still has both of his natural...
And even then...
We have Ragnaros coming after that.
Whoa.
Wow.
There's the Frostbolt.
But how do you win?
Oh, from this position? Isn't he just dead?
Well, he can stay alive, but then you lose still.
Yeah, Rag comes. He's dead.
Yeah. From his perspective, what is the best play?
Is that? 9 plus 8? He wouldn't be exactly dead. He'd be one off if he Frostbolt and Fireballed those Moltons.
Then how do you win from there, though?
How do you win? Yeah.
Like I said, he still has both of his natural fireballs
unstable
left.
Unstable portal, Deathwing.
Both of his natural fireballs are left. I guess maybe there's a chance, but he's
taking
too
much
damage.
Yeah.
There's no way he can get it in time. Rag's going to clock him.
Yeah.
Your opponent would have to screw up and life tap, and then if you draw the other fireball, you have exactly 13.
And the opponent you're talking about
is Lifecoach, so that's pretty unlikely.
Let me just make my play assuming Lifecoach will screw up.
Lifecoach accounted for that play yesterday night.
Yeah, he's been thinking about it.
Yeah. In his mind, he's just like, we simply don't tap, and we win.
It is just silly.
It is just silly. Well, this is 0%, right? Oh no, he's off by one. Okay.
Yeah. So he's like, if you got one damage, you got me.
So rather than trying to assume Lifecoach will screw up.
Let's see if he goes for the rag. Lifecoach loves rag.
You know, Healbot wins you the game here too if you want to tilt him. I would tilt him.
That would be pretty
tilting. I would miss lethal, play Healbot, and pass.
Yeah.
Lifecoach is thinking about it.
Oh no, okay.
I think that would be next level, TJ. Yeah.
I think Hellfire is the least tilting of all the options.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Good guy, Lifecoach.
Well, Reynad hates Ragnaros, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he goes with the nicest play.
All right, well, Lifecoach ties it up, and that's got to be a big relief for him because going down 2-0 in a series is something that's really tough to
especially when you're against Hunter three times.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And one of those matches you'd have to win with Handlock, and Reynad's is like the mid-rangiest of them all.
I think Lifecoach really likes his chances in Handlock versus Hunter. Of course, that matchup can't happen anymore.
Yeah, I think Lifecoach likes his matchups as Handlock versus pretty much anything.
Yeah, like Lifecoach really values just practice over everything else. He sticks with the same decks every tournament, changes maybe one or two tech choices, but he just values his preparation with those decks. Mm-hmm.
So that game, do you think it would have turned out any differently if Reynad had been more aggressive since Lifecoach's hand was so bad?
With the second Mullen coming in, he could have still gotten punished a lot. Mm-hmm. But
yeah,
I feel like that turn he didn't Emperor and Unstable Portaled instead felt a little strange to me. It seemed like he wanted to save the coin for Antonitis, but you could also just save the portal.
Yeah, the portal.
For Antonitis.
Now, it might have been a different outcome at the end of the day, but I don't think you can really fault Reynad for playing
the way he did. Both plays have their merit.
Yeah,
yeah.
Of course.
Because one Shadow Flame would have just punished him completely. Any play that he made, he wouldn't have had nearly as much of a chance as he did.
You know, I'm going to count that one to just how intimidating Lifecoach is. You are not attacking that guy's face.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You look over, you look across the table, you're like, maybe I can get a read. Does he have Moltons? You look over, you're like, he has Moltons. Okay, no.
Yeah.
We're not going in.
Yeah.
That's sort of like every matchup against Handlock is. And maybe that's why Lifecoach is so good at Handlock.
He's just intimidating. Yeah.
It's interesting. So the players are allowed to take notes. So you see the notepads in front of the players. Lifecoach just doesn't want the notepad.
Well, yeah, he's just so focused on the game.
Yeah.
Like,
Reynad, on the other hand, he takes the notepad, but yesterday, zoomed in on the notepad a little bit, there wasn't notes there. It was just a shape.
I usually...
just drew a shape.
Wait, Reynad did or Lifecoach?
Reynad did.
Okay.
I usually, like, start taking notes, and then, like, by match two, there's just, like, a few scribbles and, like, half of a word.
An Illuminati triangle.
Yeah, it's just, like, I don't know what happens.
That little weird S that everybody draws in elementary school.
Yeah.
You start out with the three lines.
Sure.
My favorite note-taking experience was in WCA. I was taking notes against Amaz. He was playing Druid.
Yeah.
I was like, okay. He kept three. And, first card he played was Wild Growth. Okay, second played card was Shade. Next card he played was Innervate, Emperor. And then I just stopped taking notes.
Then you crumpled the paper and just threw it over your shoulder.
He was thinking about, Lifecoach was thinking about keeping a quality there. I don't think it would have been too bad against the Temple Mage, just because it can clear out their first minions and they can sort of run out of steam. But he opts to go against it. Yeah. Really good hand from Lifecoach.
And a really good hand from Reynad as well.
Temple Mage drawn pretty consistently.
Yeah, if he can top deck mirror image is actually pretty good here. Mm-hmm. So I feel like we're going to see Coin Muster for sure.
Yeah, mirror images or even arcane missiles if he runs it.
He's gonna get a spare part that's gonna cost zero and be able to play Flame Waker.
Oh, he will,
And what is it?
To build your own arcane missile.
Okay, Rusty Horn.
That works.
It's really good.
Taunt the Flame Waker, I think.
Yeah. Because you're gonna trade in
He can't True Silver yet.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I think you face. Well, quality. Okay.
He's coined, you don't have to play around True Silver Champion.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So the only thing trading plays around is a quality, but
you lose three damage. Yeah.
So I wouldn't play around.
Like, again, we keep going back to this fact. Reynad is the aggressor. Mm-hmm. You have to make a risky play at some point in the game. When is it?
Yeah. So I like going face there.
I like just really quality here.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
You have to deal with Flame Waker.
Acolyte. The problem it really suffers from is when you're behind, it's a super weak body.
Yeah, you just lose tempo even more. But if you look at his hand, though, if he equalities here, he has True Silver and then nothing. So maybe getting the draw could have been worth it.
A mechanical Yeti, surprisingly.
Effective against True Silver, yeah.
He's going to have to, like, swing over two turns. He's got burn in his hand.
Nine burn in hand.
Wow.
Healbot.
Yeah, that is not good for Lifecoach. He drew all of his high-end curve with Tyrion, Kel'Thuzad, and Dr. Boom. All going to be really useless until way later in the game.
Well, True Silver doesn't do anything. Acolyte, maybe there's a chance he'll trade into it.
Yeah.
Because, like, he might want to play something that Acolyte could draw off.
Even if you did, though, you have all burn in your hand. You got to be swinging for the fences.
Yeah. You do. Of course.
So, if he plays True Silver Champion this turn, then Reynad's probably just going to Frostbolt face.
Yeah, you can't. You catch your Silver Champion this turn.
Yeah, if you play Acolyte,
he doesn't do anything. Yeah,
but if you play Acolyte, the best you can hope for is that he trades in with Mechanical Yeti.
Yeah, that's what you're hoping for.
Yeah,
yeah.
He's just probably just gonna Flame Cannon, and then he might even Frostbolt face. I don't know.
Lifecoach was looking into like a really good position until that Flame Waker turn. That interaction with the spare part.
I actually forgot he was going to get that spare part and have it cost three.
Yeah, that was really, really good.
Have it cost free.
Yeah, DJ. I can English too.
Yeah, so he's going to Flame Cannon that off. He does that so the True Silver Champion can't kill the Yeti.
Yep, and we are two off lethal.
Yeah.
Wow. If nothing happens.
And this is problematic because...
Oh, that would have been so good last turn.
Yeah, one turn too late.
He also doesn't really have any sort of duds to throw into a mirror entity.
Yeah.
Anti-Healbot is probably the best he's going to get.
Mm-hmm. He has a really slow Paladin deck, so It's not very good against any sort of fast deck, and this mage is definitely pretty quick.
So, do you...
I mean, you have to Aldor,
right? Aldor?
Yeah.
Just Aldor the Yeti and then hero power and hope for the best?
Yeah, it doesn't look like you have any other option. Like, Shredder is way too slow. You're going to be taking too much damage. You really just need to do something to slow it down a little bit.
Okay, so... let's think about stabilization for Lifecoach. Worst draw in Reynad's deck's probably...
Mirror Entity?
Mirror Entity, maybe?
Unstable Portal
mirror
into Wisp.
Is pretty bad.
Yeah, Unstable Portal into Wisp. There you go.
Mirror Image is pretty bad.
He found it.
And he has two of those in his deck. The one drops, not so good. Mana Worm, nah.
Yeah.
Best card in the deck, not right now, though.
Best draw would be, like, Fireball.
Okay. Or Emperor's pretty good.
Emperor's pretty good, yeah. The casual Emperor into Antonitis.
Okay.
Azure's really good.
It's pretty nuts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he's going to think about it for a second.
Yeah, maybe literally a second.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any merit to...
No.
You play that Ezredrake.
Oh, and now that's a good draw.
Yeah, that was really good with the Ezredrake.
Yeah.
Look at Reynad turning bad draws into good draws.
Mm-hmm. Wow. What a player. You might kill the 1-1.
I don't know, that face looks pretty juicy.
That face looks really good.
I'm sure you should count out the damage here. So he's got 9, 10, 11, 12. If he hits him for 3, he puts him down to how much? He puts him down
14.
To 14, and then he got 9 out of hand again if your whole board's wiped. So it doesn't really set up lethal with an empty board.
At the same time, you want to cash in on the Mad Scientist. So if you draw, so you have a less likely chance of drawing Mirror Entity the following turn.
Mm-hmm. And just Mirror Entity can really.
Mirror Entity is a pretty good card.
Yeah.
But you have
to talk about that.
Yeah, after the images go down, like, True Silver Champion is not useful at all. So that increases the value of the secret because Life Coach has two options right now, are either develop a minion or develop the weapon.
I would play Mirror Images here.
Well, it plays around Consecrate because Consecrate would have cleared his board anyway.
Sure.
He just. Yeah. He would have had to take 4 damage, so.
Yeah, but when did Mirror Image get good? Again, it goes back to. Eventually, they have to not have something.
Yeah.
And Mirror Image, say, consecrates here, and you saved your 0/2 taunts. You're like, hooray.
Yeah.
Now what? Like, do you draw Antonitis, hopefully, and get another Fireball off of it? I guess you can draw Flame Waker to get 2 damage off of it.
That's awfully hopeful.
Yeah, I really don't like not playing the images here, because now Life Coach can just ignore the Mirror Entity if he wants to and develop True Silver and have a fine
just token.
Yeah, True Silver token and just stabilize here.
Let me think.
Reynad's out of gas in the tank.
And
he's
then
got
you
no more
play
minions.
Minibot next turn. And Healbot.
Oh, he wants to take the Mirror Entity head on.
Yeah, I think he's still up to True Silver.
If you're True Silvering, so, I don't get why you're
I don't get that much either.
He wants to play Dr. Boom next turn.
That's strange.
But
I feel like you're probably Healbotting next turn.
Yeah.
Well, he doesn't know how much burn Reynad has, I guess.
Yeah, I might take off the shield right now.
Reynad hasn't had any of those turns that are like play nothing and just ping because he keeps top decking minions.
Yeah.
So Life Coach can't really put a like read on
also,
what those cards
he kept
are.
That mirror image.
Yeah.
Which
still turned out to be kind of bad, but
that's actually a really good point that the ping is usually the indicating factor of like burn or not, is what they ping on the board.
Yeah. He has been able to kind of track that those left two cards have been there for a while. Mm-hmm. So they're either really top end stuff. Or burn.
What to do? What to do?
And we probably will see a ping this turn. I mean, we kind of have to. The question is, do you Frostbolt face to deny the True Silver charge?
I think that damage is most likely going there anyway.
Yeah.
At some point in the game.
What to do? What to do?
Yeah. I mean, if you Frostbolt face and ping face and go all face. Images, set up lethal for next turn. Seems like a good play.
Base.
I wonder if he'll ping the shield off.
Nope. That minion has already attacked the face.
Maybe he's thinking if I'm going to lose, it's already, you know, it's too consecrate. But I don't think it is. Like, Healbot seems like much bigger of a concern here to me.
Yeah, I would just play the images.
Yeah, the images saves you
If he concentrates, he's not heal button.
He really wants those images to turn into a fireball at some point.
Well, now we're in a problem area because he had Healbot. This feels like a recurring theme.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Reynad getting Healbotted. Imagine if he tilted him with the Healbot last game. It should be even better.
Been bad.
Let me think.
Still, he doesn't have a really great way to deal with the board. If the images were played, then he would have been able to push through another 2 damage. But the minibot's going to be able to trade with one of the 2/2s.
Yeah. Well, clearly you kill the minibot.
Yeah, yeah.
The thing is, if Reynad loses this game, really no matter how he lost it, it's going to be tilting because he's had pretty good draws both games that
with
he lost.
With the same deck, with his weakest
yeah,
deck.
Yeah, with the same deck, with the deck that we've said could be the deck that has the most liability factor in his lineup. So.
And I mean, I guess Tyrion will probably get Mirror Instinct, so that's an issue, but anything like a Lay on Hands next turn could actually put Reynad out of reach. Quickly.
Yeah. I mean, as it stands, Lifecoach has 10 points of heal with the 8 from the anti-kill bot.
So he's going to take 3 extra to play Tyrion next turn.
Yeah. I think this is a great play. This is the best he's ever going to do into Mirror Entity.
Yeah, out of his entire deck.
Yeah, so he's playing the long game. Like, he knows that he needs to get rid of it right away. Uh-oh, esports!
Whoa!
Is that game? That's game!
That's game!
That's game.
Oh my goodness!
Wow. Never luck!
What
oh,
is that?
Oh, look at Lifecoach!
Reynad gives the crowd a little bit of a shrug.
Wow, that risky play from Lifecoach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. All right, well, Reynad is going to take a 2-1 lead in this quarterfinal. Gives a little smirk.
He looks a little confused. He doesn't even know how he won that.
Yeah. Lifecoach looks, I don't know, he looks a little bit defeated.
The smork life chose him, TJ.
It did.
Wow. Wow.
Jeez.
Incredible match.
Yeah, did anyone else see that ending? I did not see that one coming.
Well,
had
Reynad
to be unstable portal.
Yeah. Has 2 opportunities now to take a win with Hunter. One of them is against Druid.
It sounds pretty good.
And one of them against Paladin.
Not sounds so good.
Not as good.
Yeah.
But still possible.
But 2 opportunities, one of them being a favorable matchup. I'd say this
is either really good for Reynad or setting us up for a really salty ending.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Either way, a great story.
Yeah, he definitely has an advantage now in the series. It's all going to be down to that Druid game, though, because Druid can sometimes get the draws to beat Hunter, and sometimes he can't get the draws. So
I think one of the main things is like just Lifecoach 100% knows what he's doing with the Druid matchup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys have ever played ladder, but there's a lot of Hunter opponents.
Yeah, and he just ladders Druid all the time.
Yeah, one of the few players that sticks by Druid in crunch time to finish top 10.
Yep, loves the nature.
Yeah.
So, Reynad's Hunter, to give a little bit of a refresher, it is very heavily mid-range. It runs Piloted Shredders, Sludge Belchers, High Main, and I believe it tops out at Dr. Boom.
That's even better against Druid than, say, Hybrid Hunter or Face Hunter.
Yeah.
So, the best variant of Hunter against Druid.
He does run some aggressive tools like Abusive Sergeants, but other than that, it's... Oh, and Leper Gnomes as well, apparently. So it is hybrid, but it does have more mid-range elements than some other hybrid hunters do.
Just having the Belchers. It seems like you just cut the web spinners for Leper Gnomes sort of thing.
So
Yeah.
Leper Gnome, not nearly as powerful when you go second, because it gives the Druids something to do with their hero power if that's what they had to do.
Yeah.
It does, however, kind of deny wild growth. I know Lifecoach might just wild growth over hero powering, even in the face of a Leper Gnome.
Yeah, oftentimes it's correct too, yeah.
Right. But I mean, I think pitching Leper Gnome is actually somewhat reasonable.
Yeah.
Even though that seems super counterintuitive.
The big thing is, I think he's waiting for the mulligans to see whether or not it's appropriate to keep Freeze Trap.
I don't think he's going to keep Freeze Trap. On the coin, you
Reynad loves Freeze Trap.
Really? You think he's going to keep Freeze Trap? You have such a high percent chance to get a 2-drop.
He kept it.
Wow.
Good call,
he
TJ.
Loves Freeze Trap.
Well, he's going to get a lot of it.
He really must like it.
And the thing is,
he likes him back.
Yeah.
It's going to come in pretty big this match, though, especially if Lifecoach goes for Innervate Shredder, which I don't think he will.
Yeah, Freeze Trap generally works a lot better, though, when you have a minion on board to continue pushing damage.
Yeah.
And you can't employ the other Freeze Trap to be that minion.
There's a really bad hunter draw where you just don't draw minions. And we are dangerously close to that starting next turn.
Yeah.
His percent chance to draw a minion at this point, though, is really high.
Oh, I think that second Shredder might actually kind of bait him into innervating the first one, which is going to be really bad with two freezing traps.
Hero powering down Leper Gnome seems decent.
It sets you up for an innervate Thorisson. But that's
the
on
turn.
Your Shredder turn.
Yeah, that's on your Shredder turn. That's really awkward. And what are you going to do turn three? Like, you have absolutely nothing to do turn
you're
three.
You're going to top deck Shade of Naxxramas.
It's a 2 out of 26 times?
Yeah.
All right.
Great.
At least like we have a plan.
Well, yeah, things aren't looking great for Lifecoach. We said this matchup wasn't the best. We are seeing that now.
Yeah, and this is even when the hunter doesn't have the greatest draw.
Yeah, we're like looking at this four-spell hand. We're like, oh yeah, he's got him easy.
Yeah, and the druid has innervate still, too. And we're still saying it's pretty tough.
He likes his freezing trap.
So yeah. I'll put it in perspective. Almost every single time I've had a conversation with Reynad about hunter, freezing trap dominated at least 50% of the conversation.
Nice. Well, it's going to come into play here. Most
great.
Wonder if we're going to see the counter rope. You rope the innervate play, you get rope right back on the freezing trap play.
Just punish him. No. He's had a lot of time to think about his next play, the possibilities of what he's going to do if an innervated something comes out.
Okay.
Yeah.
He might cycle wrath.
Really? He's got a turn 4 play already lined up, and the most common drop in a druid deck is the 5 drop. So I think saving the wrath for some sort of clear play would be fine.
I think saving the wrath's probably better, and I think Lifecoach will come to that conclusion.
What?
Yeah, like in 2 cards, the odds are you're going to get a 5 drop.
Because I remember earlier this tournament, there was a play where someone cycled wrath, and Lifecoach was very against it.
Yeah, against aggressive decks, wrath is one of your best tools that.
Right.
Killing things.
Kills shredders, kills jugglers, kills little stuff.
Yeah.
Well, we should be used to this by now.
Well, he's
calculating
the probability of every little thing.
He also could be thinking of...
he's going to cycle it.
Yeah. Wow.
We were all wrong.
Crazy.
Hey, I didn't give an opinion.
Yeah,
don't lump me into that one.
Oh, you were correct, TJ. Good one.
Definitely going to cycle the wrath.
Good call. What do you think about Coin Shredder?
You know, after seeing a wrath, I don't know. I would coin that Shredder.
Now he has a minion to sort of go along with that freezing trap.
Yeah. There's a 5.
Everything's coming together. Yeah, he would have had the 5 drop in time if he had held on to the wrath.
Right, but there is a Druid of the Claw, so he at least has 1.
Maybe he's really looking for maybe Force of Nature to proc this freezing trap so he can keep his shredders on board.
If you're not going to proc it with the shredder that last turn, that basically means you're committed to hopefully getting Force of Nature because... Eaglehorn Bow then would gain charges if you were to play it.
That makes sense. So he's got 2 draws to try and find Force of Nature.
Yeah.
I think you Glaive Zooka and Juggler.
Hits the curve better. Bumps up the Apollo Treader.
Yeah, I mean, with so many weapons, the hero power value is severely diminished. You need to get these 4 weapon charges, maybe even 5 with the bow effect out of your hand.
Eaglehorn Bow does get charged from Freezing Trap, but you already have 2nd Freezing Trap, and the more charges you get of Eaglehorn Bow, the less opportunities you'll have later in the game to play Glaive Zooka.
Yep. He agrees, I think. He at least has thought of that. He's thought of Hero Power.
Yeah. It's funny watching the player's mouse move around as they, like, think.
Yeah. So, comes to the same conclusion. A Again, really just need to get these weapon charges rolling. That's two more damage, three more damage than hero power. Wild growth on turn five, not quite what he wanted to see.
Yeah. Now Lifecoach needs to decide, can he afford to wait for that Force of Nature? And it's not even likely to appear. So
I don't think you can.
Yeah, you can't.
So do you freeze the Druid of the Claw so you have stickier what? Creatures that are trading in? Or do you freeze one of the Pilot Treaders and taunt up the Druid of the Claw?
Huh.
I think those are the only two options this
yeah.
turn.
Yep.
I wouldn't mind seeing, like, taunting up the Druid of the Claw, getting one of the Shredders frozen and trading into the Knife Juggler and just leaving the Pilot Shredder on top.
I think I like Charge.
Really?
Yeah.
Charge and then trade?
Because if you play the taunt, it just dies to the weapon and the 5-3.
Okay.
And, like, this way gets you two minions.
Sure.
From your Shredder drops. And it goes along with, like, how he's been playing and protecting these Shredders so much. Oh, and that's actually really important.
Maybe he could full clear here.
I think he traded in the wrong order.
Oh! He can point his hero power at the face!
Steam Weedle Sniper. Somewhere, Zalay is super happy. He and I, we have some history with Steam Weedle Sniper.
Steam Weedle Sniper's not bad here. He can,
He can point that hero power, TJ, right at the face.
Well, he could kill the juggler with it, which isn't bad.
Smork.
You sure you want to do that, Firebat?
You sure you want to trade?
It seems pretty reasonable.
You dirty trader. Yeah, we were using Steam Weedle Sniper just to up our BM game. You play it and you point it at their face anyway. I feel like he'll probably unleash and ping off ping the juggler. Off, yeah.
Then all face with everything.
Though you'd,
except Gleebzooka trade with the...
I think that Mad Scientist might be a 2-2 vanilla.
Yeah.
Wow.
Freezing traps in the deck.
So, I mean, Reynad is kind of running low on stuff. Emperor on 6. Pretty good card.
Yeah, but in the face of 4 more damage from the Hunter, though.
True.
Eaglehorn Bow does Lifecoach do that 6 damage over 2 turns.
To make bold plays, though.
Yeah, he definitely is willing to make bold plays.
He has played Mountain Giant into facing down 4 off lethal.
Yeah.
Reynad definitely thinking it through.
I do like this Unleash here, though.
Yeah, it looks like he's just going to tank the 3. Yep.
Yeah, just so he can develop the 2-2.
Develop the 2-2.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah, now it's facing down 7 at least when you Emperor, which, I mean, you have to.
Yeah, basically.
You can Innervate Boom.
Yeah.
That kind of helps clear up stuff.
So he's going to go through all the options. So is there any merit to Emperor Innervate Hero Power or Emperor Innervate Wild Growth? Does the Innervate Wild Growth set you up for any bigger plays next turn with Emperor Thorsan?
Well, you could combo if you get it off the top, but that's only 21 damage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you're probably not going to need the combo to clear.
Well, if you were going to combo, you could just hold the Innervate anyway.
Yeah, that's true.
Problem is the Innervate over the course of the next few turns, which are all that matter. Is going to be more.
Boom.
Yeah, I think he's doing this just to try to seize backboard ASAP.
Use the boom bots to kill things.
Yeah, because thinking about it, oh, wow.
That's really good.
That's 13 damage this turn if he wants it.
I think he's going face.
I think he's going face as well. The question here is hero power or kill command?
No, you hero power.
Yeah, I think you hero power as well.
You always hero power in this sort of situation because even if you kill command later, if you kill command with hero power, it's the same thing as kill commanding with a beast on board.
Right.
Having the beast on board adds 2 damage, so it's the same thing as hero powering.
Yeah, the only thing to consider is Lotheb.
Yeah.
And if you got Lothebed into combo the next turn, that'd be pretty bad.
That would be really, really bad.
That might be the only way he could lose. And so that's kind of what he's considering right now is, if I just hero power, can I lose?
But if you do it that way, then you're vulnerable to a taunt.
And he knows...
Whoa, why didn't he attack face with the scientist?
He missed his attack, yeah.
And he's got another trap, maybe explosive trap?
Unless he planned on killing off the 1-1. And now, yeah, he has a trap out of nowhere that we didn't know of.
It's either explosive, snakes, misdirect, snipe.
Oh, it takes more time.
Oh, wow, yeah. That could have been bad.
Yeah. All right, what trap is it, though?
The button didn't do
it. You can
anything.
Even see Reynad. Like, yeah, the button didn't work. Hunter, no stupid. Well, now... that's still a lot of damage from Reynad's end.
Yeah.
But...
So, I think it's explosive.
Explosive?
Explosive would make sense. However, wait a second. Lifecoach doesn't know that second freezing's in his hand.
Yeah.
So Lifecoach is probably just like, okay, it's a second freezing.
Yeah.
We've seen a lot of hunters over the course of the
traps
week.
Get pretty jumbled in our minds.
Yeah.
So how does Lifecoach...
I have so many notes, but it's somewhere.
If he knows it's freezing, which he can... Or knows it's explosive, which he can check for by trying to trade the Boombot into the 2-3, then...
Do you not attack? And then next turn... But
you have to, like, Emperor then, I guess? To try
5-2.
You have to set up to try and kill him next turn, but there doesn't
he's
seem to be
one mana off, like, doing something really nice, because he's going to need to armor next turn.
Yeah.
See, he thinks it's freezing. Mm-hmm. And this is horrible.
Oh, no!
Oh, my God!
Whoa!
That's going to be it.
That's game!
Wow.
And like I said, thought it was freezing. Didn't even check into the minion. He was just so sure.
That is brutal.
And he misses 7 damage.
And Reynad is moving to the semifinals.
Wow.
Wow. Yeah, I don't think we saw that explosive trap in any of Reynad's games.
Yeah, he must have thought it didn't exist.
Wow. Reynad has taken down Lifecoach.
Crazy.
Regarded as one of the best players in the world.
Yeah. Well, everybody here is regarded as that.
That's true.
Yeah.
Reynad on his way to becoming legendary at this event, the Hearthstone Legendary Series.
Top 4. And it seems like his play is just getting better and better as the tournament progresses.
Yeah. And let's not forget the start of that Hunter game. His hand was double Freezing Trap Leopardome. And
yeah.
He kept the Freezing Trap and wanted the Freezing Trap.
And it worked out well.
It worked out really well for him.
Yeah.
So definitely a different style of Hunter play and doing really good.
It's such a good card against Druid, though, because they play like one creature at a time. Mm-hmm. Unless they get the Force of Nature, even double Freezing Trap just stalls their momentum for...
Yeah, really long time.
Yeah, they don't get anything going until turn 7.
Yeah, we saw he still had like almost full health at the end of that game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think even with the explosive trap out, even with an Emperor play there, don't know if Lifecoach would have been able to just survive.
Yeah.
Because he would have been set to 1 mm-hmm. with set to 2 with no way to armor.
If he traded the Dr. Boom into the 2-3 and then just played Lothar.
Yeah, but he would have taken
Ember.
8.
Yeah, and then he'd be at 1 health, so he'd be alive. So then he could, like...
He can't proc the explosive.
Yeah, he can't proc the explosive, but he'd be alive that turn.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. That's
he'd be alive to die.
Yeah. Maybe some, like, lore into something.
Yeah.
True.
Fancy.
True.
Well, Lifecoach, again, he cannot be too upset about his performance. He made it out first in his group. He took down some great players, so... unfortunately, he is out of the tournament. Reynad will move on to the semifinals to face Kit Kats. But we do have Reynad, the winner of the last match, standing by on stage with Dan.
That's right. Reynad is the winner of the last semifinal spot here as he takes down Lifecoach, one of the most prestigious players currently in competitive Hearthstone. So let's talk a little bit about that match. How do you feel? Because a lot of times people can talk about how they feel a player is doing, but you're also one of your harshest critics to yourself. So how do you evaluate your own play that series, Reynad?
I mean, it was all right. I give it like a 7 out of 10. There are a lot of like little things that I should have done. I didn't play around to quality, which cost me 3 damage in the Paladin game. So then I had to skillfully roll Corcoran. But then that was just like lots of little things I could have done better. When I played the Freezing Trap, I should have played the second one in my hand instead of the one on the far left because he knew I kept the one on the far left. So I never keep explosive against him, so it gave away what trap it was. Just like little things like that I could have done better. But I hope that I'll stop having to play Tempo Mage into Handlock because I've had to do that every single match so far, I think. And it really makes the deck look a lot worse than it is, I think. But, I don't know. I might have to play that matchup differently. Other than that, I feel like Lifecoach just played a little bit better than me that set. But, like, I don't know. I still think my lineup's pretty strong, and it definitely carried, so.
Yeah, well done. You're actually saying that you felt pretty confident against Lifecoach because historically you haven't lost much against him. And with him out of the way, do you feel like your chances are better or worse now that you're going up against KitKats in the semifinals?
I don't know. My chances are always 50-50. That's how I feel about the game. We'll see. Hopefully it goes well. I like my decks. KitKats is one of the best lineups in the tournament, too. So we'll see how that goes. There's some things in the Lifecoach matchup. The biggest mistake I made actually was playing the Tempo Mage for the second game. That was a big mistake because between the two decks I had, Paladin was favored or even against both of them, so I should have just given him the Paladin win and just picked Hunter until he had to pick it into a bad matchup. But yeah, basically shouldn't have given Handlock that win. I just picked the wrong deck. So picking order does matter in a lot of cases there.
Wow, yeah, that's actually quite the edgy statement because a lot of players have been saying that pick order doesn't matter recently in Conquest, but Reynad once again challenging the notion. I like it. So you're going up against KitKat. He's a former teammate from Tempo Storm. Is there anything on the line there, or is it just kind of another match that you're focusing because it's player versus player? There's nothing else there?
I mean, we're friends. Hopefully I win. Not much to say.
Reynad does have friends. That's right. It's sometimes we have to remind ourselves that every day. Good job, dude. You're on to the semifinals, which means we are done with our quarters. And before we begin those, we want to show you a cool segment that we had an opportunity to visit some of the players over at the Blizzard campus to take a look around.